everyone. It's great to see you tonight. If you're a visitor from Forestdale Church, we welcome you. We're glad you decided to join us. I've been here 5 months now as pastor, and it's been a blast. I have a couple announcements to make about what we've been up to and what we're going into in the future. First, this last Friday was the first time that we had a volunteer team serve the NA group that meets at our church. It was a blast. I was there with Agnes and Chuck and Jeff, and we got to serve them coffee, treats, and they were just blown away by the hospitality. They were like, wow, you guys really want to do this? And I'm like, yeah, I have too many volunteers. We need to space it out. So if you want to be a part of serving with me on Fridays, you can sign up on the back and check once a month. I will not take any once a weekers because we just have too many people, and which is a great problem to have. After the NA meeting was over, we were just hanging out and getting to know people, their first name, and getting to know their story, and it was just a great, great time. I was super, super blessed by that. The goal would be to also launch a team to do Mondays as well, but let's keep pouring into this Friday group. And if you can't be there presently, if you want, you can also serve by just making treats and delivering them to the church, and we'll set them up for you. Also, we have a few more summer cookouts left in us. Next Sunday will be our next summer cookout, and it'll be the last one that we have here at the church, because the one on the 21st will be at the Keeler's house just down the street. So be ready this coming Sunday for our last summer cookout here at the church. The final thing, I just wanted to give an update about our service time. We sent out a survey just to kind of hear y'all's thoughts on service time, and it was a split poll. 40% said that they wanted to stay with 5 p.m., 40% said they wanted to move to 10 a.m., and 20% said either. And that actually was an exact reflection of what the elders thought among us three. And so the next question is, how do we move forward together as one church? And what we've thought is, how have we treated the last couple of years at 5 p.m.? To be honest, kind of lazily, kind of just, this is just a circumstance of COVID that we're dealing with. So what we thought was, what if we owned it? What if we celebrated it and leveraged it? I don't think there's any other evangelical church in our area that has a p.m. service. So it might be a unique opportunity for us in this time for our church. So we simply want to do a trial run, if you will, of owning 5 p.m., celebrating it, inviting people into it, and praying through that whole process and seeing, is there something that we're missing out on here? Now, we're not going to do this forever. We want to pour ourselves into it and see, Lord, are you showing us something new we can do? And if not, then we'll go back to 10 a.m. But we want to actually have integrity with the decisions we make and not just flop around for a preference. But we want to see, Lord, what are you showing us? Why are we here at this time? And is there something that you have for us? So I would encourage you to join in with us, celebrate it, own it, pray for it. It's very important that you attend church. It's very important if you're a Christian, you're a member of a church. And so if 5 p.m. just doesn't work for you, I'll tell you, the church that you can go to is better than the church you can't go to. So find a church where you can regularly go and be a part of that body. And I hope that 5 p.m. Is good for you. I know for many of you, we haven't lost you over the last 2 years. And that's been a blessing and encouragement to look back on. So this is what we're going to do. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about it next week too. But we want to continue to hear from you and hear your feedback, your ideas of how you think we can make this something to celebrate and enjoy. And we just continue to ask for your prayer as we move forward one step at a time so that the Lord will show us clearly what he wants for us on a long-term basis. Well, that's a lot of info. Let's take a few minutes of silence, not a few minutes, just a few moments of silence. Let's think about the Lord, his goodness to us, and the fact that we're about to worship him together.
Please stand with me as I read our call to worship. Psalm 57, verse 9 through 11. I will praise you, Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples, for great is your love, reaching to the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music by its own. Awake my soul and sing died for thee, and hail him as thy matchless king through all eternity. Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for thee, and hail him as thy matchless king through all eternity. Crown him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave and rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring, and lives that death may Lord of life, behold his hands and side, rich wounds yet visible above, in beauty glorified. All hail, Redeemer, then, for thou hast died for me. Thy praise shall never, never fail through eternity.
Oh Lord, we just praise you. We give you the thanks and the praise that only you deserve. And Father, as we come into your presence, we do so in a spirit of confession, Lord, recognizing that although we sing these wonderful songs of praise and of worship to you, Lord, we confess before you that our hearts have perhaps drifted away from the one true being that is deserving of our worship and our praise. And so, Father, we confess those things to you now. We ask that by your mercy and by your grace, and by your great love, you would forgive us, that you would wash us, that you would make us new, and that as we go through this worship time and as we look to your Holy Spirit, Lord, we trust that as we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us, because we recognize that although we may have hurt people, although we may have disappointed ourselves and those around us, Lord, we recognize that sin is against you. And as the psalmist said, against you and you alone have I sinned. And so, Lord, we thank you for that scripture verse that says, if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive. And so, Lord, in that spirit, we want to worship you in spirit and in truth. So we ask, Lord, that you would do that washing work that only you can do as we look to be your hands and your feet and your mouthpiece, Lord. We ask, Lord, that you would open our eyes and open our hearts to the greater things, Lord, that you would have us take part in. Lord, the way in which you desire for us to bring this world a sense of your presence. We thank you for who you are. In Jesus' name.
Built on your faithfulness, my hope is held in your promises, and I take each step with your confidence, 'cause I am yours, oh, I am yours.
Sing that again. I will not fear.
I will not fear, for you are with me. And I see this fight from the victory. And no power of hell can stand against me. 'Cause I've seen this fight from the victory.
Sing that again. I will not fear.
You are with me, and I see this fight from the victory. No power of hell can stand against me, 'cause I've seen this fight from the victory.
Try.
just your name, for greater things you never fail, you never will. I trust your name, for greater things you will come through. You always do. I trust your name, for greater things.
We have one more song that we want to do as part of this opening worship time. And it's a song about joy and the joy that we have in the Lord. You know that verse, the joy of the Lord is my strength? You guys ever heard that? Yeah. How many of you heard that verse? The joy of the Lord is my strength. All right. Keep your hands up if you can tell me what book of the Bible that's from. Oh, your hands are up. Green shirt. You don't know. All right. Psalms, no, that's incorrect. I can't call him the pastor.
Nehemiah.
All right, go ahead. Nehemiah. Did you know that? Did you get it from him? Okay, very good. Nehemiah is a book about the people of God having to start all over. It's a book about work. It's a book about discouragement. It's a book about adversarial opposition. It's a book about how terrible life can be except for God being on our side. And in the middle of that book, right around chapter 8, Nehemiah says, listen, guys, God sent us to this place to do this work, and his joy is our strength. God's joy is our strength. Not my joy, not the manufactured joy that I make, but God's own joy becomes the strength that I live by. And this song just celebrates that. And I hope that as you sing this, you can do it with a spirit of gladness and joy in your heart, because his joy is our strength.
Bless the Lord forever.
again, I just want to welcome you here to Forestdale Church. Each week that we gather together, one of the bedrock principles that this church was built on and established by is that prayer works, is that God calls us to be people of prayer and to pray continually. And we take time out of each and every service each week to do just that. So we're going to just spend the next few moments together in prayer. And I would just ask you to bow your heads with me and join me. Father, we thank you that in a time of nations warring, in a time of prices rising and inflation causing such difficulties, in a time in our nation's history where we are so divided on so many issues, where there are so many hurts and hurting people, we thank you, Lord, that we can disconnect from all that, not that we don't care about it, not that we don't pay attention to what's going on in this world, but that we can tune our hearts into who you are. And in your presence, as your word says, there is fullness of joy. Father, we can't be angry, we can't be anxious, we can't be hopeless if we are truly in your presence. So Father, I ask that during this time of prayer, you might grant us this prayer request, Lord, in the words of the old hymn, that we might turn our eyes upon Jesus and look full in his wonderful face, so that the things of earth might grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Lord, may this time, when we look back on it at 6:30 tonight or at 7 o'clock tomorrow morning, when we look back on this time that we've spent together as your children, as your sons and daughters, may it fill us with joy because we have turned our eyes intentionally upon you. We sat at your feet. We worshiped your name. We confessed our sins. We asked for a fresh start. We gave our worship. We gave our offerings. We gave our fellowship. We heard your word. And we seek to put it into practice. Father, this is what it means to be the body of Christ. This is what it means to be your church. May the things that we do as your church never grow old, never fade away in our hearts, Lord. May we always see them as precious and central to what you've called us to in Jesus. And Father, as we do gather as the church, there is power. There is power in the gathering under the name of Jesus. And so, tapping into that resource, Father, we pray for this church body. We pray for one another. We pray for those that may be discouraged. We pray for eyes to see and ears to hear those around us that may be going through difficult seasons. Father, we pray for those who are struggling emotionally, relationally, financially. Father, show us how to come alongside and love people as Jesus would. We pray for our missionaries. We pray for those that are serving on our behalf. Lord, that is exactly what they're doing. Pastor Victor is serving on our behalf there in the jungles of Belize. Chikondi is serving on our behalf there across the public school system of Malawi. Walter Mudy is serving on our behalf, on behalf of all of those prisons that he goes into. The same with Dave Robbins. Lord, the Burchettes are serving on our behalf as they are there in the jungles of the Amazon. Father, fill these and the others with power from your throne to do the work that you've called them to do, to be your agents, to bring the word of God, exactly what we're trying to do here in Forestdale, to bring the word of God and the hope of Jesus Christ to those who need to hear it. And Father, may our influence go beyond these four walls, go beyond even this community. May the reverberations of your sons and daughters gathered in your name, in the name of Jesus Christ, may they turn this community, this area of Cape Cod, the state of Massachusetts, the area of New England. Father, you used this portion of your globe to start revivals in the past. Would you do it again? Would you raise up your church, your sons and daughters, to bring the word boldly and with great courage to those who need to hear it? May we never be apologetic for the gospel of Jesus Christ. May we not be people who constantly give an apology for what we believe and who we believe in. May we say with great boldness that Jesus Christ is the way and the truth and the life, and beside him there is no other. We thank you for this time. We thank you for this opportunity to give of ourselves and our tithes and our offerings, Lord. As we give our offerings, Lord, this is a central part of our worship. It's not that we have to somehow figure out why we need to give our 10%. Lord, the real question is, why do we get to keep the 90? It's all yours. It's all yours. It all belongs to you. But we ask, Lord, that you would continue to call us to be faithful, to give as you've blessed, trusting, Lord, that your work is going to go forth and is going to continue to be a blessing. We thank you for this congregation. We thank you for this church, for Forestdale Church, for its over a century and a half of faithfulness to the Word of God. We thank you for the Wormell family and Ethan's leadership as pastor of this place. May your anointing be on him as he presents your word to us here this evening. Father, we thank you and praise you for who you are. Thank you for being our shield and for being our strength, for being our deliverer, for being our strong tower, for being a very present help in times of trouble. That's the kind of God you are, and we praise you for it. As we pray these things all in Jesus' name, amen. This evening's scripture reading comes from Exodus chapter 20, starting at verse 1. And God spoke all these words: I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. Down to verse 12. Honor your father and your mother so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his male or female servant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Then the Lord said to Moses, tell the Israelites this: you have seen for yourselves that I have spoken to you from heaven. Do not make any gods to be alongside me. Do not make for yourselves gods of silver or gods of gold. Make an altar of earth for me and sacrifice on it your burnt offerings and fellowship offerings, your sheep and your goats and your cattle. Wherever I cause my name to be honored, I will come to you and bless you.
Well, typically, I'd preach through books of the Bible, but with this summer series, we're looking at the Bible from a bird's eye view. We're called this Echoes of Exodus because they show us themes of Exodus that get rung out through the story of Scripture, like an echo. But unlike an echo that gets quieter and quieter until it fades away, the echoes of Scripture actually get louder and louder, begging for resolve until they finally find their fulfillment in Jesus Christ. The echo we're going to hear today is Torah. This is a Hebrew word for law. When the Lord gave the Ten Commandments, he called them his Torah. Today we're going to see the purpose of God's law and that it actually still has a application and relevance for our lives even today. But to see that, I'm going to need help from a couple friends I made up. Pius Patrick, and Pagan Pam. Well, have you ever noticed that sometimes the most miserable people in life are the ones who keep all the rules? We might not want to admit that, but we have to be honest. Sometimes it's true. It doesn't matter where you're from. I'm sure you've seen this man before. The one with the nicest lawn in the neighborhood is the one who's grumpy and always scowling at children. His car is always waxed. His taxes are always done. Every blade of grass is in its place, and he is miserable. This is Pius Patrick. Totally follows all the rules, almost obsessively. A Pius Patrick believes that obedience is not a means to an end, but it's an end to itself. Yet what we see is that living like this only brings guilt and shame. It robs you of all joy. Why? Because deep down, as every Pius Patrick knows, it will never be enough. They know the things about themselves that nobody else knows. They know that they still have vices. And these vices bring deep guilt and shame. You can have all the discipline in the world in other areas of life, but still never get rid of it. This is why sometimes the most miserable people in life are the ones who keep all the rules. You might think, well, who could live like this? Something's got to give. And you're right. Tired of the guilt that comes from the inner law within, some people reject it altogether. Have you ever seen a child that grows up in an ultra-conservative home and then completely turn the other way, totally rejecting God's law and anything that smells like it, pursuing a life instead of self-indulgence? Well, meet Pagan Pam. Pagan Pam was finally able to break free from this miserable, law-centered, oppressive upbringing of Pius Patrick. She adopted a new law to live by, a law of the self, which is really the law of self-indulgence. This law says, don't restrict your desires, set them free. Only then will you finally be able to rest and have peace. But have you ever noticed how people who live like this keep reinventing themselves? We might think to have no law outside of ourselves is a liberating thing, but it actually leaves us without any direction and purpose in life, resulting in anxiety and uncertainty. It only leads to an aimless life without direction. That's why in this lifestyle, we keep reinventing ourselves, hoping to find peace, but we never do. A sociologist of religion found that those who pursue autonomy, what we talked about a couple weeks ago, they become, quote, uncertain of the norms by which life is supposed to be governed, and ultimately uncertain of who or what he or she is. So on the one hand, you have those who totally follow the law. On the other hand, you have those who totally reject it. Yet Pius Patrick has no joy. Pagan Pam has no peace. All of us are somewhere on this spectrum, trending to be more like one or the other. This is why we need to look to Jesus. Because when we look to Jesus in the Gospels, we actually see how Jesus solves both problems at the same time. And this is what I want to show today, our main point. Because Jesus fulfilled God's law, we can live with joy and peace under God's reign. Whether you find yourself today more like Pius Patrick, or you find yourself more like Pagan Pam, or some mixture of both, you need Jesus, and I need him too. So to see how Jesus changes everything for us, let's just look at three points to get us there. First, the law of God. Second, we're going to look at the law of Moses. And then third, we're going to look at the law of Christ. So first, the law of God. What does a law do? A law makes what would be a random group of people into an organized people. It creates a whole new people group. I mean, the political way to put it is a law constitutes a nation. Law gives civilization structure. And of course, the power of law can be abused, but when it is used according to its design, it actually organizes power dynamics and protects and directs the citizens of that kingdom. It's the same with God's law. God's law was used by him to organize his kingdom. We see this in Genesis when he creates the garden and the citizens therein, Adam and Eve and their family. He uses a law to organize this new kingdom. Be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. You're free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat from it, you will certainly die. Well, now as we go through the story of Scripture, we see in Exodus how God delivers his people, the descendants of Abraham, from slavery in Egypt, and he's bringing them to a promised land. Now, along the way, he constitutes them as a new people by giving them a new law through Moses at Mount Sinai, which is the account that we read in Exodus 20. But there is a law that's of God that stands over and above all people, regardless of what time in history you lived in or what national identity you have. Because it's from the creator of the world, this law compels all people. It's often called the moral law. The moral law of God was established at creation when he created the world, and it still remains today. We read of it in Psalm 19, that the glory of God is seen through his perfect law. And yet, you get to the end of Psalm 19, and what is he doing? Confessing his sin. Because he knows under the moral law of God, even he has sinned. Everyone has sinned for violating God's law. In Romans chapters 1 and 2, the Apostle Paul will echo what Psalm 19 shows us. And says that the law of God is written on our hearts, whereby the whole world is subject to God's judgment. We even see in the New Testament how this moral law of God holds secular societies and their political leaders accountable. Although the moral law of God is stated for us in the Ten Commandments, we don't need to read it to know it, for it's written on our hearts. You never taught your children to hide when they stole snacks. They already know they shouldn't steal. That's why they hide. The law of God is written on their little hearts because they are creatures made in God's image. Well, that's the law of God. Now to the law of Moses. When we get to the book of Exodus, something new happens. God gives his law to his covenant people in order to constitute them as both a religious and a political nation. He gives them the Ten Commandments, which is the law that's written on our hearts. But he brings a detailed application of this law to Israel's newfound identity as a political people. The Bible sometimes refers to this as the law of Moses, sometimes the law of the covenant, or just simply sometimes the law when it's in the context of the Israelite nation. So what I mean by the law of Moses is not that Moses gave them this law, but God gave them this law through Moses at Mount Sinai. Well, a large section of Exodus details the new laws for this new nation, both civil laws and ceremonial or religious laws. Things pertaining to animal sacrifices, how to keep ceremonial clean so that you can continue to come to the tabernacle for worship, what foods were kosher, even sometimes what clothing you're allowed to wear. Well, this civil and ceremonial law of the Israelites represents how God's moral law was to be applied to this new people, this special people, Israel, and their new national identity. Now, I say civil and ceremonial because these are different aspects of their law. Civil law tells them how to be governed as a nation. Ceremonial law tells them how to be governed as a religion. But they had a single law code for it all because as a nation, they were inherently religious. Their civil and ceremonial laws were one and the same. I mean, an example that we might see even today would be Islam's legal system, Sharia law, which governs both civic and religious life at the same time. Well, we'll learn a little bit more next week about how the law of Moses worked in the tabernacle and the special function it had for God's people there. But for now, you've graduated law school, and we're going to move on. I want to point out just one more thing, and that's the altar of atonement. The altar of atonement. In Exodus 20, the Israelites received the Ten Commandments, as we read. But did you notice before they receive their civil and ceremonial law, they need an altar of atonement. Why? They've already broken God's law. That's all they need, the Ten Commandments, the moral law of God, to show that they are sinners before God. The Lord reminds them, don't make any idols to worship. But don't put your tools away just yet. There's actually something you do need to make. You need to make an altar in order to offer animal sacrifices. The Israelites needed a way to be forgiven for their sin. They needed a ritual so that they could maintain their purity and continue to dwell with God, this holy God. They needed a substitute to take their place in judgment. And in his grace, God receives this substitute of animal sacrifices. Well, now we finally discovered the problem with Pious Patrick. He has an altar to make atonement for his sins, but he puts himself on the altar. He has no substitute. He takes the punishment every time. He punishes himself with guilt and shame, and shame and guilt. And he thinks, well, maybe if I discipline myself in other ways, I'll feel better. So he mows his lawn. He waxes his car. He stays in shape, but it never rids him of his guilt. And he becomes bitter. No wonder he can be so holy, yet so unhappy. Now, how would all this play out for the Israelites? As the account goes, their journey through the wilderness to the promised land only affords them opportunity to doubt in the goodness of God's law. The people consistently rebel against God's law and are brought back and forth between judgment and restoration time and time again. The Lord spoke through the prophet Isaiah, "All day long I have held my hands out to a disobedient and obstinate people." The problem was simply this. They could not keep God's law. Their nature was bound to sin. As the Lord said to Moses, if only they had a heart to fear me and keep my commands. Well, the account of the Israelites, as we read it through the books of Joshua, Judges, Samuel, Kings, and Chronicles, is really just a story about how Pious Patrick becomes pagan Pam. The Israelites, not able to keep God's law, totally reject it. And as a result, they're lost without direction and purpose. We find them constantly reinventing themselves, don't we? Whenever they come to another dead end, they say, well, let's be like the Egyptians now and make a golden calf. Only to be lost at that dead end and say, well, God, save us. We're lost without you. What happens as time goes on? Let's be like the Philistines. Or let's be like the Midianites this time. Or let's be like the Amalekites this time. Or let's be like the Babylonians. And on, only to be led to a dead end after dead end. Until they repent and say, Yahweh, save us. We're lost without you. They thought they were free from God's law, but they found out they were simply enslaved to the curse of sin. So the Lord, in order to make good on his promise to their forefather Abraham, makes a new covenant with them that's not like the old covenant that he gave them with Moses. He says to the prophet Jeremiah, this is the new covenant I will make with the people of Israel. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts, and I will be their God and they will be my people. The Lord will speak through the prophet Ezekiel to say something similar, that he will do this by giving his people new hearts altogether by the work of his spirit, so that they wouldn't simply follow after God's law, but they would actually delight in following after God's law. Well, when we fast forward from the prophets about 400 years, the scene opens up for us with Jesus in the Gospels. The Israelites are now in their promised land, but they're not an independent nation, are they? They're under Roman rule. Now, the genius about the Romans and their conquest of the ancient world was that they, when they would conquer a new territory, they would take your politics but let you keep your religion. That's why in the Gospels, though the Jews can no longer enforce their civil law, they can still enforce their religious and ceremonial law. They're very concerned to do that. In fact, a group of new Pious Patricks rises up, the Pharisees. They were experts in Israel's law code that was given to their people long ago at Mount Sinai with Moses. They added detailed guidelines on how to keep the Mosaic law in areas of life where it was uncertain. Some scholars count over 600 laws that they had written down. They saw how in times past, it doesn't go well for us when we reject God's law. It only plagues them with anxiety, fear, and all kinds of misfortune. They said, those pagan Pams. Fools. See how all that self-indulgence brought to you? So they went to the other extreme and became pious Patricks. This is where we come to see a new law through Jesus, the law of Christ. Jesus starts teaching about the law of God in radically new ways. And yet his logic is so sound. No one can find a way to beat him in a debate about a commandment. An easy thing to do would be to accuse Jesus of just getting rid of God's law altogether. But Jesus makes an astounding statement. He says, do not think I have come to abolish the law of the prophets. I haven't. I have come to fulfill them. When we look at Jesus, we see how he brings a solution to our problem with God's law. Whether we are law keepers who have no joy, or whether we are law breakers who have no peace. He solves both problems at the same time. And as a result of what he does, two things happen to God's law. One, it's fulfilled, and two, it's upheld. That's what the law of Christ is. The law of Christ is the law of God fulfilled and upheld on behalf of his people. Well, last year for our anniversary, Catherine and I went ziplining. Who's ever been ziplining before? For those who are unaware, some people wrap a thick cable around a tree, and then they wrap the other end of the cable to another tree, usually across a big canyon, and then they ride the cable. Sounds crazy, I know, but it's far safer than it sounds. You're strapped into a harness, and the harness is connected to the cable. You actually don't even need to hold on to the harness. As long as you're strapped in, you'll get to the other side. Well, a lot of people are nervous when they go ziplining. And that's understandable. But it's a little funny at the same time. Because they hold on so tight to their harness. They're so nervous that they let go, they're going to fall. Not knowing that the harness is actually holding them. They're not holding themselves up. They are, in fact, not dependent on their own strength. They're dependent on the strength of the harness to get them across. Well, one day, an ambitious young man came to Jesus and says, what must I do to get to the other side? What must I do to approach God and inherit eternal life? Jesus says, keep the commandments. It's not complicated or hard to understand. How can we as human beings approach God? Easy. Just obey the moral law as revealed in the Ten Commandments. Never lie, cheat, or steal, and all the rest. This is the problem with Pius Patrick. He is depending on his own strength to do it. And we've already seen how it works out for people like that. But Jesus shows us another way. If you read the Gospels, you'll see Jesus say to many people, your sins are forgiven. The Pharisees are always greatly offended at this. They say, who is this who thinks he can just forgive sins? Well, the Apostle Paul will explain it like this in Romans chapter 3. He writes that Jews and Gentiles alike are all under the power of sin. As it is written, there is no one righteous, not even one. And this is why no one will be declared righteous in God's sight by works of the law. Since the righteousness of God that we need cannot be achieved by law-keeping, since we are lawbreakers, it was made available to us another way. Paul says in Romans chapter 3, verse 22, this righteousness that we need is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference between Jew or Gentile. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. How? God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood, to be received by faith. Well, just like the animal sacrifices of the law of Moses served as a substitute in the place of sinners, Jesus was provided by God to be a substitutionary sacrifice, to which all other sacrifices pointed, all the sacrifices of the Israelite law code pointed to Jesus. Hebrews chapter 10 says it like this: unlike temporary animal sacrifices of the old covenant, they needed to be offered again and again, quote, we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. Jesus laid his life down as a sacrifice for sins, as the true sacrifice, so that he could exchange his own obedience to God's law for our disobedience, taking on our guilt and giving us his joy that he earned. John chapter 1, verse 16 and 17. We have received grace upon grace from the fullness of Christ. The law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus. So then, for those of you who are in Christ Jesus, before God, you're accepted, not on your own works, your performance, how good you've been lately. Your position before God is based on the performance of Jesus Christ and his perfect obedience on your behalf, how good he was. You're secured in the harness of the righteousness of Jesus Christ, and you're set on a sure path to dwell with God in a heavenly inheritance that is based on his obedience for you. Well, praise be to God, right? We're not left to be like Pius Patrick. God has provided a way for you to experience the kind of joy in your life that the guilt and shame of sin never would let you have. Now we can live with God in joy, not in fear or guilt or shame, because our redemption is assured. God's pleasure in us is secured when we have received the righteousness of God that comes by faith through Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul writes in Romans 5, verse 1, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Well, I urge you, if you've not placed your faith in Jesus, for whatever reason, know this: God raised Jesus from the dead, authenticating his own message and displaying him as the true and divine Son of God. So, in light of the death and resurrection of Jesus, receive his public offer of salvation by repenting of your sin before God in prayer and receiving Christ alone. Well, the law is fulfilled in Christ. That's the first thing we see. But here's the second and last thing we'll look at. The law is upheld. The law is upheld. Earlier, I made the case that ziplining is safe, but I did not say ziplining is fun. If you're strapped into the harness, you will get to the other side. But if you don't hold on to the harness at all, you'll just flail around upside down until you get there. In fact, the way you hold on to the harness directs which way you turn. It changes your position. I learned this from the instructors when we went ziplining. You can adjust your grip on the harness ever so slightly to turn left or to turn right. You don't need to hold the harness to get to the other side, but you do need to hold the harness if you're going to enjoy the view. Well, we've seen the joy that comes when we knowing that we can approach God freely because Jesus fulfilled the law. But how can we, as redeemed human beings, have peace in our journey rather than flail around the whole ride of our Christian life? How can we enjoy the view? Pagan Pam is depending on her own law, the law of self-indulgence. We've already seen how it works out for people that try it that way. Jesus shows us another way. The Pharisees asked Jesus, which is the greatest commandment? Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind and strength. The second is like it, he says, love your neighbor as yourself. Well, what's Jesus doing here? He's simply restating the moral law and summarizing the Ten Commandments. Love God and love others. Because when you do this, he says, you'll fulfill the whole law. Well, as I mentioned, Jesus said to many people in the Gospels, your sins are forgiven. But do you know what he so often follows that up with? Now go and sin no more. On another occasion, he says, if anyone's going to follow after me, he must deny himself and follow me. So rather than freeing us to the law of self-indulgence, Jesus calls us into the law of self-denial. He makes us new kinds of law keepers altogether with a whole new set of motivations for obedience. We're freed from guilt and we're filled with gratitude for what he's done. Now, two questions should come to our mind at this point. One, if Jesus upholds the law, why don't we continue with the civil ceremonial law of the Israelites when we gather for worship? And second question, if we're free from the penalty of sin, then why are we still called to such strict obedience? So here's the first question. Why don't we continue on with the civil ceremonial law of Moses? Well, the law of Moses was for the Israelite theocracy. And God put it in place to teach his people and the world different things about the Messiah that was coming. As the New Testament author of Hebrews writes, the law of Moses was only effective to purify sins because it pointed to the one true sacrifice, Jesus Christ. This is why when Jesus died on the cross, what happened in the temple? The temple curtain tore from the top down, signifying it wasn't something man did. Why did the temple curtain tear? It was no longer necessary. It was no longer necessary. We have been purified once and for all, given holy access to God through the Holy Spirit. Paul writes about this all over the place in the book of Ephesians as we've gone through. We see more evidence of this in Acts 10, when the Lord reveals to Peter that all food types are now clean for his people, signifying that Gentiles have been included in God's new covenant people. In Ephesians chapter 2, Paul summarizes it like this. The death of Jesus on the cross brought the law of Moses to its expiration date. It had done what God had given it to do. And now Jesus has made a way. So the civil and ceremonial law of Moses had expired, but the moral law of God, as reflected in the Ten Commandments, has not. The Ten Commandments reflects the law that's written on the heart as creatures made in God's image. That's why the Ten Commandments are reinforced in the Gospels and in the letters to the churches through the New Testament. So now to the second and final question here. If we're freed from the penalty of sin, why are we still called to obey the law of God? The Apostle Paul explains it like this in Romans chapter 6. Sin used the law of God like a tool to beat us down. But since we have been justified by God through faith, through Jesus' obedience rather than our own, the power that sin had has now been removed. So the law can now be used for its original design and ironically actually bring blessing to our life rather than just condemnation as sin beat us down with it. In Christ, we now can turn to the law and receive the good that it brings, which before sin never let us experience. It directs us toward God's good design for life where we will find peace. Romans chapter 6 says, thanks be to God for this, that through Christ, or that though we've been slaves to sin, we've now been free to obey from our very heart. And praise be to God. We're not left to be like pagan Pam either. This is such good news. God has provided a way for us to know him and do what pleases him without the penalty of failure. So when we're wondering what we should do in a given circumstance in life, we can turn to God's law, which says, love God and love your neighbor. We live in a world, listen, isn't this bring so much peace? Think about the world we live in. We live in a world where it seems that what is right and wrong, what is true and false, changes all the time, doesn't it? Don't you see the peace that we have resting in God's perfect law that never changes? The Apostle James calls it the perfect law that gives freedom. Zipping down the line, harnessed in Christ, we still hold on to our harness. But now, not because we're afraid of falling, but because we want to enjoy the view. Because Christ fulfilled the law on our behalf, yet he upholds it all the same, we can have the peace in life that our self-indulgent life never let us have before. This is the good news of the gospel. that because Jesus fulfills God's law, we can have joy and peace under God's reign. So let us rest in the gospel. Do not rest in the law, whatever you do. Rest in the gospel this week. Regularly preaching the gospel to yourself. For only then will we be able to obey God out of gratitude rather than guilt. And only then will we be able to obey from the heart. Well, let's pray together. Father, we thank you so much for your word and the freedom it brings to our life. In our sin, we might shudder away from hearing you speak, knowing that you're the God of the universe. But if we wait a while, we'll hear your message of grace through Christ. And I pray that for those who do not know you, that they would come to know you truly through Jesus. And I pray that the believers here, those who are in Christ, would be strengthened again in the gospel to live a life of joy and live a life of peace this week because of what Christ has done for us. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
One more time, my word.
is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
And a light.
And a light.